Right, one all in the series, and as the old cricket cliche goes, it's all to play for in Melbourne. Very privileged to be joined by the brand ambassador of CricketNext, Anil Kumble, joins us from Bangalore to look ahead to the Boxing Day Test match. Anil, thank you so much for your time.
Pleasure. Pleasure, Gaurav.
Before we look ahead, let's look back. First of all, let me put you on the spot with a yes or no question. If you were in charge, would an Indian 11 ever play without a spinner?
Not really. I think you need a spinner. You need the combination to have, because you need a bowling attack which can bowl in all conditions. Because at the start of the game, unless it's a green top, unless you know that when you bowl, you're going to dismiss the opposition in less than a day, then you take a chance with four seamers. And when you know that, the wicket is going to remain like that throughout the test match, then there's a possibility that you can look at four fast bowlers. Otherwise, you always need a spinner. And you also look at the opposition as well. As an opposition, Australia hasn't always had good results against good spinners. And India has some fantastic spinners in their lineup. So, when you look at the opposition, no matter what the pitch is, when Australia has struggled against spin, especially this team where there's not much depth in their batting lineup, with the Aussies, you would always have a spinner in your team.
Let me give you the converse view, Anil, that has been expressed. One, obviously, Ashwin would have played had he been fit and available. And Jadeja, we are not now hearing, wasn't completely fit. As a result, India probably did not have the option of fielding a frontline spinner unless it had to be Kuldeep Yadav. Would you have gone for that option had Ashwin and Jadeja not been available and only Kuldeep was?
No, if both of them were definitely not available, then then you didn't have a choice but to go with four fast bowlers, because I think Kuldeep requires another spinner at the other end. I believe that Kuldeep requires that because he's still young and lead spinner, it's too much of a risk. But ideally, you would want someone like a Jadeja or an Ashwin at the other end when Kuldeep is playing. But Jaddu, I thought, fielded on a couple of days in the Perth Test match. So I'm not really sure what the extent of injury was.
Yes, sir, not very clear on exactly what's happened. Anil, before we look ahead, one other issue, and you could throw light on this as a former international player, captain, coach yourself. How is it that that professional cricketers, team managements end up misreading conditions? We saw this happen at Lord's as well, when India played a couple of spinners in on what was a wicket that was clearly favouring faster bowlers. And now it's happened at Perth as well, where India have actually not played a spin bowler. How is it that this kind of thing happens when guys who've played cricket and been around cricket all their lives are assessing conditions before a game?
No, it's very difficult for me to judge from this far. But, generally, you try and plug all options. When you pick a team, when you pick a playing 11, you try and, take the skills of players who can contribute irrespective of what the conditions are, number one. Number two, if the conditions do deteriorate and do help the spinners, then you need that option. In this current cricket team, when I played, there was Sachin Tendulkar who could bowl and pick up wickets. Virendra Sehwag could run in and bowl spin. Whereas in this team, other than Hanuma Vihari, and he's also part-timer. He's not like a Virendra Sehwag or, for that matter, Sachin Tendulkar who could bowl spin. So in that kind of a situation and a scenario, I'm surprised that, India went without a spinner.
Would you go as far as describing it as a blunder?
No, I think, like I said, if both the spinners have been injured, then you probably didn't have an option. But then, you would have preferred to say that up front rather than now. That's something that I don't know why the team management did not mention about Jaddu's injury. But, having said that, I've been through shoulder issues and I've taken injections on my shoulders. It does take a little bit of time to settle down. But when it is settling down, the last thing that I want to be doing is throwing from the deep. And that's something that I wouldn't want to do if my shoulder is settling down from taking an injection.
Yes, let's wait and see how this unravels. Let's look ahead now. Anil, quite clearly, it doesn't seem likely now, or it would not. If you were making this choice, it would be very difficult now to field an Indian 11 that opens with Vijay and Rahul, given what's happened in the first two test matches.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. I mean, you know, KL Rahul has been, we know what the potential of KL Rahul is. Unfortunately, he hasn't, turned that into performance, consistent performances. I mean, last year, he was really good in terms of, contributing in test matches as well. He had some big hundreds, but unfortunately, he's fallen by the wayside. I think it's not just his technique, which he's probably doubting at the moment, but also his mind. I think it's good to have to give him a break and then perhaps, make him play the longer format in domestic cricket. I think that's a good option for Rahul. I don't think you would like to go with Rahul at this kind of a mindset. I believe that Mayank Agarwal has done exceptionally well in domestic cricket. He's flown in, given an opportunity, straight in.
All right, so Mayank Agarwal comes in for you. I just wanted to stay on the Rahul discussion with you. You know, from a distance, obviously, there's a lot of psychoanalysis done, all of that. However, let's talk specifically about a technical flaw which seems to have crept into his game. He keeps getting out bowled and LBW a lot, Anil. If you're watching this as a coach, what would you be looking at specifically? Why does that happen to a top order batsman consistently?
No, I can only think of two things. I've not been a batsman who's scored a lot of runs in international cricket. But then if you look at it from a technical aspect, all I can think of is probably he has all these insecurities about not doing well in the recent past. And those, gremlins are in your mind and you're constantly thinking about, when is my big innings coming through? Maybe those thoughts are in his mind and probably he's not watching the ball that closely enough, from the hand. At any batsman, whether you're a top-order batsman or a lower-order batsman or a bowler who can just, hang on, you just need to watch the ball really, really closely from the bowler's hand. If you're not picking from there, then you are slightly fraction of a second late. And that we know in international cricket when the ball is being hurled at you at literally 145, 150 kilometers per hour, you don't have a chance to even put the bat. And maybe that's why he's missing the ball and getting bowled.
Right. So your point of view seems to be that Rahul now needs a break. But what about Murali Vijay? There has been some thought that India needs to be completely radical with their thought process here. Maybe look at someone like a Vihari who's shown some good technique lower down the order and is a top order batsman in domestic cricket. Maybe him, he also becomes an opening option alongside Mayank Agarwal. Would you like something like that to happen or stay with Vijay?
See, I think Murali Vijay showed a lot of character in the second innings in Perth. I think, his 20, he was solid. He looked comfortable. Maybe I may be tempted to go in with a Murali Vijay for one more time. But if you look at the last, 15 test matches or 12 or 14 test matches that Murali Vijay has been a part of, he's just had one century and that too against Afghanistan. So in that sense, since if you look at it's not just about the openers here. You also need to think of the combination. You need to play five bowlers because we've seen that MCG last year was a flat deck when Australia played England. If it is going to be similar, and we have seen that the faster bowlers have done an exceptional job in the last two test matches, both in Adelaide and in Perth, where the time between those two test matches wasn't, you didn't have enough time to recoup. So, India has had about a week off after the Perth test match, going into MCG. Would you still want to go with only four bowlers, maybe one spinner and three fast bowlers? Would you want to do that? Or would you want to have five bowlers, two spinners and three fast bowlers? If you're doing that, then your combination at the top really changes. And we have seen that the openers in the series haven't really contributed much.
Yes.
So, in fact, you would look at that opportunity of perhaps looking at Hanuma Vihari open the batting. I've been really impressed with his temperament, his skill, and his ability with the defense. And his technique looks very solid. He looks composed. He doesn't get rattled by the situation, nor with the faster bowlers really bowling quick. So I think he has in him to possibly look at as a makeshift opener in this game.
So let me confirm this. You're okay, Anil, if the decision is made to open with Mayank Agarwal and Hanuma Vihari in Melbourne?
I'm okay with that, but there's also another option. Whether you want to look at a Parthiv Patel to open the batting and then keep wickets, that'll mean that Rishabh Pant, who's done really well behind the stumps and also contributed with a bat lower order, would you want to do that or would you want to push Hanuma Vihari at the top? That's a call that, you would want to take. But you know, going by, if you want to keep Rishabh Pant, who's done well, who's a youngster, who's, you know, learning and doing well, he's the future. So I guess you would still want to keep Rishabh Pant and perhaps move Hanuma Vihari at the top.
One other selection call that will need to be made is what has happened since we last spoke, Anil, is India have called up Hardik Pandya too to the squad. Now, he's played the one Ranji game, which was maybe a trial of sorts for the management to get a sense of where he's at. Again, as someone making a decision of this kind, would you throw him into a test match of this importance straight away, given the game time he's had off late?
See, I think the only option that you would consider a Hardik Pandya is if you're looking at him as your fourth fast bowler in a five-man bowling attack. That's the only option. If he is your third fast bowler, then I won't consider Hardik Pandya because he's had too little a time. You would rather go with two spinners. If both Ashwin and Jadeja are fit, then perhaps both of them. Or if Jaddu is still not recovered and if Ashwin has recovered, then maybe throw in Kuldeep there. And then we know Kuldeep has really troubled the Aussies in the test match that he is, the one test match that he's played against them. And also, against Australia in the one-day series. So if it's a flat deck, maybe, it's worth having someone like a Kuldeep at the other end. So I would certainly look at a five-bowler theory because the faster bowlers have really done the hard work and bowled really well. They've been relentless in the last two test matches. And it's been 100 overs. Both these test matches, the bowling attack has bowled 100 overs. So it's not easy to come back into an important test match, with very limited rest, coming in with only three fast bowlers and one spinner. So I would prefer to have the fourth option, whether you want to go with a spinner or whether you want to go with Hardik Pandya. Both Jadeja and Hardik Pandya give you enough with the bat as well. But probably Jadeja will give you more with the ball, especially in the second innings.
So lots of decision-making for the management to do. It was the kind of thing that Anil Kumble did when he was a coach and captain of India in times past. Let me also ask you one other aspect of this. Now, Anil, we've seen the middle order seems to have a more settled feel to it. Rahane's got some runs. Kohli got this lovely 100 in Perth. Pujara got 100 in Adelaide. I wanted you to touch upon Rahane in particular. Do you see something's gone a little missing from his game? Because there was a time when he was so reliable and would make big hundreds. Seems to get starts and then gets out to very un-Rahane-like shots. What are your observations looking at him from a distance, Anil?
No, he's a quality player. That's why I don't want to tamper with the middle order. I mean, Pujara has to bat 3, Kohli has to bat 4, and then Rahane at 5. Because, there will be a temptation if you're looking at, Pujara moving up the order to open the batting. I mean, that's something I don't think you need to even consider. So yes, Rahane has done well. He's had some good starts. He's had a couple of 50s. But, somehow I get the feeling that, he has it in his mind that he needs to be really aggressive. And then he's a stroke maker. I mean, he's a stroke player. He will play his shots. And once he's set, he's a wonderful player to watch. He just needs to relax and maybe just postpone that thought. Every time when you're in a hurry, when you're for some reason, probably he believes that he needs to be aggressive in a middle order and get the game moving. Maybe that's his thought process, especially when the spinner comes on. So I think it's important at that point in time as a batsman. I mean, it happens as a bowler as well. When you're really bowling well, when you know that the wicket is helping you, you start thinking of too many variations. And when you're thinking of too many variations as a bowler, the one thing that you tell yourself is to postpone that thought by a ball. And that probably applies to a batsman as well. When you're thinking too much, saying, I need to be playing shots here, I need to be hitting boundaries, it's a good thing to just pause and say, let me think about this the next ball rather than this ball. I think that will certainly help him. He's a quality player. He's shown us in the past how he can build on an innings and get those big hundreds. India needs him to get those big hundreds in the middle order.
Anil, again, just again from your vantage point and having worked with the players, This year, Virat Kohli in particular has just taken his batting to another level. Like they like to say, the cliche that's been used, he's taken it to another level. But he really has. In terms of the tough runs he's made in South Africa, in England, and now in this 100 at Perth, what's your assessment of him as a batsman? Do you sense that he is now at the peak of his powers as just pure test match batting?
No, absolutely. I think, you know, one thing that you need to tell, or you need to, when you look at his career over the last couple of years, is that each game, he's not only improved his skill level, he's taken it to the next level. I mean, irrespective of the conditions, but also mentally, you know, he's under control of everything that is happening around. He's, you know, he has the ability to take the team along with his batting. He has matured, and then you can see it. The way he literally controls the game. I mean, he doesn't play too many loose shots. He doesn't look to hit in the air, even when he's batting with the lower order. You know, he controls the game. And you know that if he crosses that 20-30 mark, you know that he's going to get 100. You know, that's been the beauty about the way Virat has, you know, done over the last few years. He's been able to convert those starts and make a big score. And that's something that I think someone like a Rahane, someone like, you know, the opening batsmen who haven't really done well, need to learn from. If they can get a good start. I mean, Murali Vijay got a great start. He got 20. He struggled really hard. He fought really hard to get that 20. But he was not able to convert that into a big score. That's something that Virat has done consistently over the last couple of years and made sure that he puts the team in a really, really good position. And that we have seen is not just because of his skill level, but also with the kind of mental ability that he has of controlling all of you know, the distractions, all of that he's able to channelize and make sure that he's watching the ball closely enough to make sure that, you know, he does all the right things on the pitch.
Let me ask you the question that always elicits the headline then. Are you seeing shades of the great Sachin Tendulkar in Virat Kohli already?
I think you can't compare. You know, I think it was different era, different opposition, different, you know, I don't think we need to compare. But he certainly is a great player. You know, in terms of numbers, Virat has what? Already 60 international hundreds in such a short span of time. He's hungry. We know he's extremely fit. You know, when he gets an opportunity, he makes the best use of it. And he makes it count. I think that's the ability that Virat has. And I don't think we should start comparing. He's a great player of the modern era, and we should just accept that, and you know, and help him just make you know, go out there and then do his job for the team. Because it's not just about Virat. If you have to win a series, it's also about the other players contributing and making sure that the team gets to a position of strength. And we have seen that Virat has been consistently performing. So has Cheteshwar Pujara, consistently performing. And I did say before the start of the series that, yes, with these two performing, you can win a match. For you to win the series, you need the others to perform as well. And probably this is the time that the others lift their game and perform for India to win this match and also win the series.
Let me ask you a little bit about the Australians. Anil, you did we did speak before the series and then after the first test match as well. And you were saying that you should expect fight from Australia in the second test match. Were you impressed, just looking from the outside, at how feisty they were in this game? They weren't exceptional performances with the bat, but they all came together and really produced a very, very eye-catching, hard-working performance to win the test match.
Yes, they did. You know, we all know that Australia, irrespective of the quality of the team or the opposition, they will come hard. And probably the venue helped as well. It was the first test in Perth, and not just that particular ground, but, you know, Perth in itself has a huge legacy of Australia winning and really destroying the opposition. So maybe that certainly geared them up and helped them get come together. Their batting was far... better, they were controlled, they let the ball go. Otherwise, if you look at Adelaide, you know, all their batsmen came and they made it look like they were in a bit of a hurry to get those runs. So they took their time. And once you have a good opening partnership, you know, that's what Finch managed, you know, although it was not a really big partnership, but they had that 50 partnership, opening partnership, because that's very critical as well. You know, when you're fighting against a team which has high-quality opening bowlers, you need to get through that first session without losing too many wickets. And that's what Australia did. And that's exactly what India hasn't been able to do. If they can do that against Australia, then they will be one up. That's my understanding. The openers are the key. So Australia will certainly be, again, if they have to go past India in Melbourne, they'll have to make sure that they get a decent partnership at the start of the game.
Now, as one of the leading lights of the club, the most, perhaps among the most eminent members of the Spin Bowlers Club, all your from all the achievements you have in international cricket, what is your assessment of Nathan Lyon? Is he on his way to greatness, Anil?
No, he's a fantastic spinner. I mean, he's quality. He puts a lot of revolutions on the ball. The ball dips. His line is impeccable to the right-handers. He, has the advantage of a Mitchell Stark bowling over the stumps and then creating some sort of a rough. Not necessarily that he gets a lot of wickets from the rough, but that certainly puts a doubt in the batsman's mind to play that ball or to go for it. And he's been brilliant. You know, from there, he has the ability to take the ball on straight on and also spin it from there. And, the advantage that Lyon has had over the Indian batsmen is because the openers are not getting a great start, the batsmen, the middle order, are always under pressure when he comes on to bowl. So it's a bit different. That's why I'm a bit disappointed that Murali Vijay was not able to convert that 20 and get on to a big score, because he has the ability to take the spinners on. He's a good player, and he's the old-fashioned opening batsman who gets through the tougher part of the new ball and then goes after the spinners, which he was not able to. And that's the reason I think he's been able to settle into a good line, good rhythm, because the Indian batsmen haven't been able to take Nathan Lyon on. But high quality, he's been consistently performing, and everybody felt that it would be Mitchell Stark, Pat Cummins or Josh Hazlewood who will be at the top of the list of wicket takers. But after the first two tests, it's Nathan Lyon. And nobody expected that. But that's credit to Nathan Lyon.
In fact, Anil, leads me to one other narrative that seems to be developing over the last few years, which is India's batsmen against spin bowling. Surprisingly, there seems to be some sort of frailty there. What's your reading of why that is starting to happen? Why India's batsmen increasingly, is that something to do with domestic cricket? Is that something to do with technique, skill, how the modern games are evolving? Why India's young batsmen are struggling against quality spin?
No, I think, I think it's a combination of both. Modern day players are constantly looking to attack the spinner. And, as a bowler as well, you're setting fields with a little bit of a in-out field, as a spinner. So you don't get too many boundaries, too many opportunities. And the modern-day batsman is, I'm not saying not adept, but probably doesn't have the mindset to play the waiting game and then say, okay, let me take a single, let me milk the spinner rather than look to hit boundaries. That's number one. The other factor that is probably playing a key role is not enough international players play domestic cricket. When you play domestic cricket in the Ranji Trophy, you come across a minimum of two spinners, and you're constantly challenged to take the spinner on tough wickets. The wickets will be spinning. There are times when there's a lot of rough, underprepared pitches, and those kind of opportunities and challenges that one faces. So that's why the Hanuma Viharis, the Cheteshwar Pujaras, and to an extent, Murali Vijay, are a lot better at playing spin, because they, play Ranji Trophy at some point in time before the international test matches. So in that sense, a combination of both, I think it's important for the international players also to play domestic cricket whenever the opportunity arises.
Before we finish, Anil, I wanted your thoughts on one aspect of the broadcast which seems to have caught a lot of attention. This the stump mics being turned on and players being heard we've heard a lot of Rishabh Pant off late. There's also been some incidents that have happened. As a player yourself, as a coach yourself, and someone who dabbles in broadcasting too, what's your take on this? Should this be permitted?
It's a debate. I think it's an experiment that the broadcasters are currently on. I think as a player, when you're playing, you're oblivious to all of these. You know, you don't care about which camera is looking at you, where the stump microphone is. I don't think as a player you're thinking of any of these sort. I think this will certainly get discussed in the cricket committee meeting. It's debatable. I mean, there are times when you wouldn't want players, what they say, to be heard in a family room. And there are times when the players do get frustrated and say things on the field. But then again, you know, when it is there, it's also entertaining. You know, there are times when there is a little bit of banter going on, and this is professional sport. So it's a balance that one needs to look at. And you know, I think I'm sure it'll eventually work out in a way where there will be a bit of a balance in bringing this to the homes of viewers. So I'm sure it'll have its initial discussion and discourse, but eventually there'll be a bit of a balance.
Yes, I'm sure we would have enjoyed hearing what Anil Kumble had to say when a catch was dropped off his bowling, but you escaped that time, Anil, from while playing.
I think those were enough heard by my colleagues. I think all my colleagues keep talking about it whenever you know, we meet now and have a discussion about our time of you know, of playing together. So I guess it's common knowledge now that you know, I had a bit of a go at my players as well, but not necessarily in explicit language. But then I certainly showed my you know, frustration.
Right, let's let you go. But one final thought, and I'm going to put you on the spot on this one. Assuming everyone is fit and available, pick an 11 for us for Melbourne, Anil.
Come on, Gaurav. I haven't even seen the pitch, but yeah, I'll try and have a crack. I would certainly have Mayank Agarwal walk into the playing 11. I think it's nice to get a youngster kind of energy that you need. We have seen Hanuma Vihari perform. We have seen Kuldeep Yadav perform. We have seen Rishabh Pant perform as a youngster. So why not throw, Mayank Agarwal in the mix? So him, then the challenge, because I need five bowlers, because the fast bowlers are tired. You won't go with any other three fast bowlers to be playing. So it'll be Shami, Bumrah and Ishant. So these three fast bowlers need backing up. So the two spinners, I will go with experience. Ashwin and Jadeja both can bat as well. So those five form your bottom five. So you will go with Hanuma Vihari, test him out, try and push him up the order, and then have Pujara, Virat, Ajinkya and then Rishabh Pant as your wicketkeeper. So that will be my playing 11. And if things go well, looking at the pitch, I think you will need two spinners if it's a dry surface.
Excellent. We'll wait and see how it goes. Anil, sticking to 2-1 for your prediction from the start of the series?
Yeah, sticking to 2-1. Yeah, I think so. I think India still has a chance to build on the first test match. Second test match, I think the combination was a bit of a lopsided. The batting, especially the lower order, was very fragile. So that's something that they need to plug in. So if they do all of that, I think still India has the upper hand. I mean, the quality is still with India. Australia batting hasn't really looked formidable, but the challenge is that India has given Australia a little bit of a foot in the door, and that's something that probably whether Australia will get in or will India close the door, we'll have to wait and see.
We'll wait and see, and Anil will speak to us after the end of the Melbourne Test match. Thank you so much, Anil, for your time.